Welcome to the Femsplainers. I'm Danielle Crittenden.
And I'm Christina Hoff-Summers.
And we are very excited to have cocktails today with a guest. Actually, we have to admit, we had cocktails with a little while back, Claire Lehmann, editor of Quillette in Toronto, when we were up there.
Yes, wonderful interview about an absolutely indispensable online forum.
Right.
It's just a journal of ideas with articles on topics you just don't read anywhere else.
Right.
Independent thinkers who are worried about extremism on the far right and the far left.
Right. And she's part of what we like to call now the intellectual
blonde
web.
Yes.
And we had a lot of cocktails with her when they had this party in Toronto. And we'll explain all of that in the interview with her. But then we very soberly interviewed her the next day. So, but before we get to that, there's just a ton of stuff we've wanted to catch up on that we don't always get to the topics and articles that we get so into our subjects that we overlook some of the fun things that we want to talk about.
Fun and serious.
Well, yeah. So Christina, there's been a bunch of, we could call this your inbox. What has been on your inbox that you haven't gotten to?
Well, I haven't been. Well, this is fairly recent. The mimosa mandate has passed.
What?
In Georgia.
There's a mimosa mandate?
Yes. Everyone must drink mimosas.
I'm for that.
No, it's not in Georgia. And apparently it was a very troubling state of affairs. During the brunch on Sundays, boozy brunchers had to wait until 12 o'clock to be served.
Mimosas?
Mimosas. So they had a referendum.
They could have bourbon or something before then. No.
No alcohol. Some one of these laws that left over from Prohibition days. But they've overthrown it. And now you can have your mimosas at 11 a.m.
You know what? I'm against this on the principle that I'm against mimosas. Because Look, I'm not a big fan of champagne, as you know. But why to a perfectly innocent glass of champagne would you pour orange juice into it?
Well, I use Prosecco.
Well, even still.
No.
And you know what? It's one of those drinks. I always calculate my drinks by calories. And I don't mean do I drink the, you know, least caloric. It's are the calories I'm going to have worth it?
Yeah.
You know, it's going to be 100 to 200 calories either way. Why am I wasting it on a mimosa?
That's how I feel. Like, even with candy, if it's something fantastic, like a Snickers bar, it's worth it. You go to hotels, they have Snickers bars because they know very few people can resist.
I'm always tempted by the $20 jar of cashews, which I...
Oh, God.
Like the restraint needed not to...
And the $11 little
gummy bears.
No, and Pringles.
Oh, Pringles, right. The $11 elegantly presented Pringles. Yes. But no, and also the problem I have with mimosas is, you know what they lead to? Brunch. And what is one of the worst meals ever conceived?
Yeah, I don't like brunch.
Brunch.
But I think the idea of mimosas is I will have them because it feels like you're not really drinking. It's just orange juice.
Yeah, but then you get those silly calories. And brunch, let's be clear. Brunch is, as we know, neither breakfast or lunch. It's served too late. They have eggy dishes. I like eggs. But by noon, I neither want to really drink or have breakfast.
Yeah.
I'm just against, you know what? I'm against the whole thing.
I do. Can the Femsplainers take a position on this?
And
are we against the mimosa mandate?
No, I'm not against, loosening the laws.
When I read it, I thought it was the state of Georgia had a mimosa mandate. And I thought, what an affirmative mandate for us.
You know what I could be for? A Bellini mandate. Now, Bellini is what a mimosa should be.
And wants to be, but never will.
Right. It's such a Bellini wannabe.
Yeah.
Bellini is with a little peach schnapps and a little peach juice sometimes and champagne. And it was invented at Harry's Bar in Venice.
Is there a little leaf?
Yeah. You might do a little
something.
Garnish,
it's perfect.
It's perfect. All right. Well, Christina, I'm glad you're taking this inbox very seriously. And the cocktail mandate was at the top of your inbox. Moving down, I was very taken by a story that appeared that Google vice president told his employees to stop using the word family after staff complained the term was offensive, homophobic, and excluded unmarried people without children, animals, and those with multiple trans feminine partners.
Do they have to be trans feminine?
Well, I think it's just basically saying this idea that you are two parents. Hey, and I'm sure they're open as to whether they're same-sex parents or not, or trans parents or not.
There are all kinds of families.
But I think the key component to our traditional understanding of family is the inclusion of children. And I think that's what set the Google employees off.
So they have to say domestic units? I mean, what is this? It's ridiculous. I mean, and I sympathize because I consider, I mean, I think if it's...
Go on, say it.
Yes, Izzy and I constitute a little family.
You would marry Izzy if it were allowed.
No, I want to marry you.
Oh, I forgot that. This has come up. I think this is the third time you proposed
Izzy
to me on the podcast. But no, okay, the person here says at Google that the word family is not equal to having children, and Google should stop the use of it in that context.
Who said that?
Some employee.
Oh.
And various employees said they referred to animals, spouses, boyfriends, parents, and multiple trans feminine partners as their family. And it was also said not all children have families, so the words aren't interchangeable. So I get this strays. Like, what child doesn't have a family?
An orphan.
There's no such thing as orphans anymore. They're foster families. They're families.
Everyone has something. Or they're talking about the live-alones.
Children?
People.
Live-alones?
No, adults who... Yeah, some kids live
home alone.
That kid.
Well, look, I'm with this idea that, yeah, look, especially as you grow older, that if you're lucky, you build up a network of friends, pets. You're right. Some of my children's friends, I consider family. We call them fake daughters and sons,
right,
in our house. So I get that. It's like a wonderful broad concept. And yes, we're getting into unconventional parenting models and households. But in the end, let's be honest that from a state point of view, having children is bringing the next generation of citizens. You want to encourage that, presumably. And to your own personal idea, you can consider many things family, but from a state or corporate point of view, what are you trying to help? You're trying to help people who are raising the next generation of citizens to encourage that and to help that. And to...
Yeah, I agree that it's odd that they would object to this on so many levels. Because first of all, the word family is already inclusive of all kinds of arrangements. If people
Labradors live, and Maltipoos.
Look, we had the Manson family. You know?
Mass murderers.
It's as inclusive as, you know, they weren't married.
Squeaky was very upset by the language. The Manson family didn't have health care. All right, your turn.
Okay, an article that I found eye-opening and important was actually what I have is the actual article in the journal, Plus One. It's about gender inequality, and they looked at key measures of well-being, like life expectancy and educational opportunities. And what they found was that overall, the majority of countries, women are faring better than men on these fundamental indices of well-being.
Right. And they based these, this was carried out, I read, again, as I always do, I read the potted history and you read the actual history. You read the actual study and I read the summary of the study.
Right.
It was carried out by the University of Essex and University of Missouri-Columbia. And they created scientists created a database that deciphers a country's discrimination called the Basic Index of Gender Inequality, or BIGI.
Biggie.
They based it on three factors: educational opportunities, healthy life expectancy, and overall life satisfaction. And this is where men had trouble, right?
Not a lot of trouble, but to the extent that there were differences in very, you know, the sort of advanced, highly developed industrial countries, the men were behind the women. Right. The countries, the relatively few, where the women were doing worse than the men tended to be the very poor countries.
Right. And that was about access to education.
Yeah.
Apparently.
Access to and life satisfaction. I mean, women are unhappier.
It was a little skewed in the sense that most developed countries in the world come closest to achieving true gender equality. But in the most developed countries, there's a slight advantage for men, it was seemed.
Right.
And that was based on
a
men.
A slight disadvantage for men.
Right, right. Or slight advantage for women,
yeah.
Sorry. So the harder places for men were based on men receiving harsher punishments for the same crime, compulsory military service, and more occupational deaths than women, and also men generally everywhere tend to live less long, right?
Live less long. I mean, they don't say that's discrimination. In fact, I wouldn't call it discrimination. We don't know. Mm-hmm. Some of it may be the fact that women live longer than men may be just, you know, written into our biology.
Mm-hmm.
But
if you were a man, you would say it's discrimination.
Yeah, well,
it's genetic discrimination.
Well, men are medically neglected. I mean, if you look at the institutes of health, the CDC, other agencies, massive representation for women and organizations. The CDC has an Office of Women's Health. Where's the Office of Men's Health? It doesn't exist.
Right.
So it's partly because men don't have these activist organizations making sure that their interests are represented. Now, on their behalf.
Also, they would say, history, health has been based on male models and just bringing women's health into the mix, and that the fact that women.
Well, the fact that women have babies, I mean, that you're automatically involved in the health system, and men can sort of stay away from it. And I think women are more acclimated to it when they have to care about birth control and things like that. They're more likely to be involved and have a doctor. So,
well, also not to sound like a radical feminist, but weren't most health studies previously based on just using...
Yeah, but it's not clear that that was a big advantage for men. It was they would use, prisoners and soldiers because men were sort of disposable.
But that's why women, and it's like when women have a heart attack and our symptoms are completely different from the classic, and it's actually quite scary when you learn this, that totally different from the classic, the pain in the arm, the sudden clutch to the chest, that apparently, when women start having signs of a heart attack, they don't even know it. They think it's like flu or stomach upset. Like it's.
Do you think I had a heart attack the other day?
No, I think you had the flu. No, but I mean that's like so. I think to be fair, it's like a lot of the health studies we're getting are, and you're right. Women's health is different, but it's been separated out not to discriminate against men, but because. We've had to separate it out because everything else previously used to be lumped.
I mean, on the one hand, we're supposed to say, the sexes aren't all that different. Well, they are different, at least in terms of health. And men tend to die of the major killer diseases 10 years earlier. On the other hand, women are, like psychological illnesses, women are more vulnerable to anxiety and depression. And men, schizophrenia and, severe.
Well, it's a weird thing because I'd love to go up to, say, some feminist radical and say, is women's health important? Yes. Well, why is women's health different from men's health? Like, if we're not biologically different, and if everything is socially conditioned, why aren't we having the same heart attack signs?
Yeah, well, they'd have some explanation, I'm sure. They'd say, well, that was just the, gender role.
Men bottle it up.
Yeah, and they were taught to do it. But anyway, the point is that why I think this, to the extent that this is an important study, there is another gender disparity study that's done by the World Economic Forum. You know what that is? They meet every year at Davos. It's this just a prestigious group. They meet in Davos. It's about 2,500 people of leading figures, in business and politics. Bono, Mick Jagger.
Bono,
take that out.
Anybody who says Bono, which, by the way, is something I do too, it remembers the real Bono is Sonny Bono.
I think of Sonny Bono.
Bono, yes, go on.
Mick Jagger, as I said, Angelina Jolie. And the purpose of this gathering, which is admirable, they brainstorm to think of how can we make the world better? What can we do? And ever since 2006, they produced this yearly report, which is the Global Gender Gap Report. And they look at countries around the world to see who's achieved equality. And they have 20 or, I don't know, dozens of measures. And it's a little strange because it ends up every year like a country like Rwanda beats the United States for gender equality.
Yeah, exactly.
Just because everybody's so far behind. There's this, you know, everybody dies at a young
age.
They're
all
the
same.
And another weird thing about it is that if men are doing worse, that doesn't count against equality. They only count if women are doing worse. So, you know, in Russia, there's a huge health gap between men and women, and a death gap. And it's one of the largest.
Oh, right.
In the world.
And also, it's not helped by the poisoning of men by the
right. A lot of things go
dropping dead mysteriously in consulates.
Yeah, exactly. So, but that doesn't count against them. The only thing that counts against your equity index is if you have women are behind. So what these researchers did, Gilbert Stoat and David Gary.
This is back to the study.
Back to the study I like.
Right.
Is they're using a lot of the same data as the World Economic Forum. But what they did is they counted how men are doing, again, you know, and how women are. They measured that. So it's not just the difference between men and women only based on how women are doing. It's men and women, and they count men. Their scores matter, and you get a very different picture.
Okay, but I'm just gonna burst your bubble,
okay,
Christine.
Okay.
Because I was all with this, right? Like, it makes total sense. You go, and then they say, like the top. So the way they measure this is like the closer you are to zero, as in differences between
right
the sexes, the you know, the better the country.
Well, not necessarily, but. Yes.
But they're the closest, as they say, to achieving true gender equality. So they claim that the UK, US, and Australia all discriminate a bit more, not like hugely against men, whereas Italy and Israel and China are harder environments for women. Italy was considered the best place, even though it slightly favored males, it scored the highest. And you go, okay, I get that. Italy's pretty great. I could live there.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly. And that
maybe a few wolf whistles now and then if we're lucky.
Right.
but then, okay, and then you go, Israel, yeah, that makes sense. And both sexes are conscripted.
Right.
And then, you know, you have poorer populations and refugee populations. So, okay, yeah, I can see that.
Right.
Guess what is the third top-rated place for women? The top-rated place for women. Okay, so Italy and Israel slightly favor men, but they're overall considered great.
Right.
Guess what the top-rated place for women is?
Mozambique.
Saudi Arabia.
Oh, right, right. I know.
Not
I remember that.
Joking.
I know.
Followed, ladies, this is where you need to go to, Azerbaijan.
Yeah.
And Indonesia.
Right.
Canada comes in at 23rd. Great Britain comes in at 24th, just noting behind Guatemala and Madagascar, although Switzerland's up there.
Okay, but
China and
but,
Turkey. Turkey was number four for
right.
women.
So this is what people have to understand about these studies, and including the Davos study. It's not a measure of how overall wonderful life is. It's just a measure of how different it is for men and women in a country. And you come out number one if there's just the smallest possible number.
Saudi Arabia?
Well,
maybe women are happy staying in their houses.
I agree. I made an entire video about the World Economic Forum, what they get wrong, because they got Rwanda ahead of Denmark.
I know, but come on.
Mozambique,
Arabia?
Burundi.
I can't get over that. I can't. And then United States, by the way, just in case you're wondering, 61. Following closely behind Kuwait and Iran. Iran comes after Iran.
Now, if this piece of research does nothing else than discredit the World Economic Forum it will be worth it because every year...
What? You keep going back to this and I'm just laughing this, like Saudi Arabia is the best country for women. It's,
and they said Rwanda.
Okay, maybe, you know what? Forget the studies.
Live your life.
Enjoy
but
democracy.
It is interesting. The one thing
enjoy I've, not wearing a burqa.
There's an important lesson here. If you just look at the difference between men and women in a country, a slight difference between men and women isn't a measure of discrimination. It isn't a measure of well-being. You have to look at the picture as a whole. And do people have freedom? So in the World Economic Forum study, they get a lot of credit. That's one reason Burundi and Rwanda come on top is that they get like number one in political equality because they have mandates and quotas for members of their parliament. So they may have no freedom. I mean, I'm not saying they don't. Who knows what's happening?
They're just getting false statistics.
And the statistics aren't that good.
Okay.
But anyway.
All right. Well, moving on. Last inbox item before we get to Claire. So this is from something called, honestly, I'd never heard of it, Mel Magazine.
Oh, yes.
British, right?
It's British, but I think it's what's called SponCon. Sponsored content?
No.
Sponsored by? Yes.
Oh.
It's sponsored by the Dollar Shaving Club.
We're for that, though, right? Not Gillette. We're against Gillette and
for the Dollar. No, everybody was going to move to Dollar because of Gillette, but now...
I don't care if this is sponsored content because the article was really, really interesting. What's sponsored by... the shaver, but it's a legit
Mel,
article.
What does that stand for?
I don't know, but it's a
Men for the Elimination of Liquor. No,
lingerie.
Of lingerie. Men for the Elimination of Lust, Lingerie, and Liquor. And this is actually true.
No, this
They prefer, the guys that run this magazine
yeah.
prefer yoga to vodka.
Okay, you know what? You are turning our audience again. You are influencing our audience.
Oh, no, but there were some good things in the article, so let's
proceed. Okay, it's a fascinating topic. Let's just say that, and we can discuss. So the article was called When YouTube Red Pills the Love of Your Life. And this was about we all have or know, and maybe we are that person who watches too many YouTube videos and develops conspiracy theories. And I mean, we saw this through the election. We see this at our family tables at Thanksgiving. But this one is the effect on women dating or even married to men who suddenly get caught up in the kind of men's rights world. And it's not incels. The incels are the involuntary celibate. They're the losers in the basement, probably of their parents' house. They've given up on ever having any kind of relationship. And they go on Reddit and write horrible things about women. So this is one step up from that. And this is clearly men who were sort of seemingly normal and these talks about these relationships, the women were dating them. And then all of us, well, not all of a sudden, but
gradually,
but fast, these men cotton onto these YouTube videos and suddenly these women are faced with the fact that their boyfriend or husband is telling them that they're feminist indoctrinated,
whores and bitches, and using language like that, and denigrating them, and then moving to like very right wing conspiratorial politics about the encroaching takeover of the society.
Right.
Immigrants and so forth.
And they call it red pilling because, of course, this goes back. Actually, I'm just going to read it right from the magazine because it does, even though it goes back to the movie The Matrix and everything.
Right.
It says the term red pill refers to the internet's manosphere, a collection of male-dominated subcultures that ranges from the incels to men's right activists who believe that liberal left-wing politics have waged an all-out war on white heterosexual men by promoting abortion, immigration, and LGBTQ issues.
Do men's rights activists care about abortion?
No, but they feel that they're being undermined by leftist activists, among whose causes are abortion. And The Guardian in 2016 described red pill communities as a network of groups that collectively envisioned, quote, a reality that women run the world without taking responsibility for it, and that their male victims aren't permitted to complain. Well, you know what? That is traditional. Of course, you know, there's that old Jewish joke.
Yeah,
about,
yeah.
You know, okay, you know the punchline. I'll just say it for those who don't know the punchline. A Jewish man and woman, husband and wife, are talking about, the man's talking to a friend of his, and he says, you know, well, I make all the important decisions. I decide, you know, what I think our policy, our president should think about China and, you know, world trade and you know, the really big and important decisions. So my wife decides where we go for vacation, where we're going to live, right, what we're going
to
eat,
where the kids go to school.
And this is a little bit about this. And yeah, you're not permitted to complain. So it's kind of like a politicization. We could argue it's, even though it's considered right wing, we could consider this a politicization of a traditional view of the world.
Just a traditional dynamic.
Well, I guess men got in the old dynamic. In their minds, the romanticized version is kind of Mad Men, where, yes, they made the quote-unquote big decisions, but they got a martini delivered to them and no sass. Would that be fair?
Yeah, I think there was some sass, but it's complicated.
They're very sassy now.
Says
I will
Zoe.
Say there are a lot of red pill people that comment on a lot of your Christina's content.
Mm.
And when I search for listener feedback, I get to read through all of the
One of them, I'm not going to name him. One of them made a video attacking me as a, what did he say, that I was a stealth feminist? No, I'm not a stealth feminist, dear.
What does that even mean? Do you stalk?
I don't know.
She's undercover.
I'm working for the international conspiracy of
because you're feminist. You're pretending that you're not really a feminist, but maybe you
deep
are.
Down inside.
Well, what do they say?
Oh, I've just on the content we put out about January, we got tons of angry red pill people just attacking the women that introduced January.
This is where you grow your hair.
I posted a picture as a beautiful girl.
Oh, that was
it. Was that
glamour.
One? That's
glamour.
The one.
That was
but
hilarious.
Really, really hairy legs.
Yeah,
it was actually
there were so many. There were so many funny comments to this, and actually, we're gonna do. Zoe's gonna do a little listener feedback after.
But let's just finish with this article.
Because
I had some problems with it. Did you finish explaining it?
I think so. What I was fascinated it was they interviewed a few women to whom this had happened. And it started like, and usually it was like a fairly like liberal woman, you know, just very typical. And she dates a guy and they're having great conversations. And then for whatever reason, like in this case, one of the guy changed shifts and he had a lot of time in the day. And she said, this woman, I think her real name is not Sarah. He said, because he'd work at night, he'd spend the day on the internet. He'd be watching them, the videos, and send them to me throughout the day on WhatsApp, over email, anywhere, really. And during one work meeting, she received videos from him about, quote, a migrant invasion to Britain orchestrated by Angela Merkel and Barack Obama, which showed Libyan refugees getting off a boat, carrying large bags and shouting, thank you, Merkel, played over dark orchestral music, and other videos supported Donald Trump's proposed ban on Muslim immigrants, diatribes on feminism, threatening traditional family, and scientific evidence suggesting that white people have higher IQs than black.
By the way, have you
Asian
ever
people.
Run into videos like this? I remember once I saw a video from Sweden, and it showed like a beautiful girl being chased into a underground tunnel.
Oh, I think I did.
By a bunch of apparently they were identified as Muslim immigrants, and it was frightening. It was a fake video, I looked at it and I was about to say, "Oh my God, who is this?"
Because it played to your
No, it didn't. I didn't know what I was seeing. Anyone would see it, and you know. But anyway, don't forward videos unless you are sure that they're accurate.
Because. Right. Well, no, but it's also there are these videos. They play into very
into prejudices and fears.
Expertly into fears. And what was actually very poignant in the end about this story was, you know, you're reading going, okay, to me, I'm reading going like, ooh, time to dump that guy. Like,
yeah,
let's go, ladies. And they stayed in it, not just for months, but even a year or two, and one of these women, and they started to change they really tried to accommodate these men and tried not to argue with them, even though they profoundly disagreed, just to keep the relationship going. And honestly, I found that a more interesting fact of the article than the fact that there are these men going off the deep end. And you know, with a lot of, as we talked about in the world, discrimination, certain pressure. But that these women would do everything. It was Richard Spencer's wife.
Yes.
This was interesting. Oh, okay, Christine, how do you feel about this? So Richard Spencer's wife leaves him, right? She did leave him, and complains about physical abuse and being subject to physical abuse. And then people start saying, and then the right's very sympathetic.
Was she a captive? Did she have no choice?
Right.
And she, I mean, she's with a person that's so just completely overwhelmed with hatred and anger and toxic in every way. And she's surprised that this.
Well, I think as somebody said on Twitter, like, wait, the right is all sympathetic when he's, you know, taking his Nazi-like stances and bashing blacks and everybody else. But, oh, physically abuse your wife.
Yeah.
That's over the top, dude.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Anyway, well, it's an interesting. I really want to actually explore men's rights movements more.
Yeah, well,
this is my one. Yeah,
I have a few problems with this article. It's called "When YouTube Red Pills the Love of Your Life," and I read it, and it at the core there was an important point, which is that if you have depressed people or lonely people or just upset people, unemployed people at home. They go on the YouTube. They can find their way anywhere. And there's dangerous places for everyone.
Right.
And it may be that there's just a growing number of disgruntled young men who have problems with sex and love. And then they end up, somehow, that takes them into, like, extreme right-wing.
Well, it feeds a sense of aggrievement that is, I think, very free floating around right now, and again, understandably, but still, you know,
yeah. Well, that's important because in this article, as I read it, I started to question even the. I mean, first of all, it's an author in this dubious site, but it doesn't matter, Mel, and.
You should support it because it's the Dollar Shaving Club.
Also, I found out what MEL stands for.
Oh, thank you.
It is the MEL scale, which is a scale for measuring auditory pitches as perceived by the human ear.
Oh, yes. I did not know that.
And they've made a magazine of that?
In the About section, it says, we write about dicks a lot.
Okay, whoa. You said that right when Christina's phone went off.
So what if my phone goes off? It's real. It's,
oh, my God.
It's
realism. It's real and sad, Christina.
It's not sad. It makes us more just...
No, it doesn't.
What is it? It's cinema verite. Cinema verite. So
all right.
This YouTube red pill thing. Here's what bothers me. Not that it was a dubious spawn com, but it reads a little bit like a liberal feminist pipe dream or a left-wing pipe dream. So these girls, I have this nice boyfriend, and then he somehow starts listening to right-wing videos. And before he was bringing me flowers, and we were going to have Chinese brunch.
And being cool and thoughtful.
And then the next thing I know, he's calling me a bitch and a whore, and he's reading me articles about why removing taxes from tampons isn't a good idea. I just can't.
Right.
And then... it goes on, gets worse and worse, and he becomes a right-wing nut. And then it describes, in one moment in this article, it sort of set, so it's like Jordan Peterson is the entry drug.
Right.
And then the next thing you know, they graduated to Steve Molino, and then then we're Richard Spencer.
Right.
And they collapse huge categories. There is a manosphere. It's got a lot of different...
Hey, on Reddit, the red pill pages have more than 200,000 members.
Yeah, but...
It's like one of the biggest community pages.
And probably Jezebel has a lot more followers than that. And in fact, Mel, the editor-in-chief, said he envisioned a kind of Jezebel for men. So,
okay, but
and
you
this
know what?
Does
that's
reach.
Good. But then that's good. But let's just agree, because we have to obviously go to our interview with Claire.
Yeah.
But let's just agree that I really want to revisit the men's right activism.
You know what?
Movement.
We should talk to it. See, and I also wish, as a piece of journalism. He's reporting on the anonymous reports. So it's secondhand reporting from an anonymous person describing a third person. I'd like to hear from the third person just what they have to say. And if this is accurate, we have no way of knowing exactly how accurate this is, although I'm sure these sorts of things happen.
Okay, Bob Woodward, we'll do that.
No, and then they collapse things like men's rights activists.
Okay.
I'm just getting started here.
No, stop.
Oh, God. Okay, I'm calming down. Okay.
We're going to go to our interview with Claire. Okay.
And then we'll go back. Can we go back to that other and talk about the
disparity?
No, stop it. Okay.
Give this woman a stronger drink. Okay, we're going to go to our interview with Claire, and then we'll just have at this point, super short follow-up.
Sorry.
Traveling in a freighter combi on a hippie trailhead full of zombies. I met a strange lady, she made me nervous. She took me in and gave me breakfast.
Welcome to Toronto,
yes.
Where we are in Canada at the E1
headquarters.
Entertainment One, our network overlords. And we're here because mainly to interview this amazing guest we have joining us in the E1 studio, which is Claire Lehmann.
Yes, mistress of the intellectual dark web.
Founding editor Quillette.
Yes.
And you had a big party here last night, and you're going to have to explain to our listeners. To those who don't know what Quillette is, but also you're Australian, the events in Toronto, and a lot of your followers are American. So
yeah,
and
right.
It's the winter.
I was amazed by how many people had traveled a very long way to get there. It was quite astonishing.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a lovely
turnout, yeah. And so lively and well done.
And quite cool. But tell us about Quillette.
Yep.
And it's only a couple of years old, right?
Yeah, so I started Quillette in November 2015. Prior to that, I was a graduate student in psychology. Mm-hmm. And I left my studies and was figuring out what I was going to do next. I was a young mother. I had a baby. And I decided to start an online website. And I worked hard at it for a year and a half.
And just on your own?
Yeah, all by myself.
With a baby.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not that hard to create an online magazine, but I did have to teach myself a bit of coding, a bit of web development. You know, my skills were really tested, and I had to, there was a very sharp learning curve, that's for sure. I was lucky that I had a fantastic network of interesting people, academics, writers, and so forth to draw on. So I had contributors straight away.
And were these primarily Australian or?
Actually, there were people who I knew through my Twitter and social media network, so many Americans.
Tell us how, because obviously you're not a young mother in the outback of Australia with that obviously, or just a random graduate student who decides to start a magazine.
Yeah.
Tell us a bit of your background and the reason you felt Quillette was needed, and maybe how you had all this ready network.
Sure. Well, before I started Quillette, I had done some blogging, and I probably since 2013, I had done some writing for the Sydney Morning Herald, the newspaper in Sydney, and I had my own blog, and I commented on feminism in particular, and I had written essays about contemporary feminism being at times scientifically illiterate or using assumptions which are not based on evidence and empirically validated theories. And so this was an interest of mine, these gender narratives that are so often promoted in the media. It was an interest of mine to look at them from a scientific point of view. And so I was writing about those issues. And so I attracted the following of several academics in psychology, in evolutionary psychology in particular. I was friends with Christina Hoff Summers online prior to beginning Quillette.
Yes.
And we were, I mean, I had always been a fan of Christina, so it was such a thrill when he followed me. So we had this network effect. So we had a group of academics who were sympathetic to what I was writing. When I said that I wanted to start up a magazine, they said, oh gosh, can I get published with you? They trusted me. Mm-hmm. So I published them, and then the network effect kept building. So their friends who are also having something to say got in touch with me, and it kept building from there. And now we have hundreds of contributors all over the world.
And hundreds of viewers. And
yep.
I read in a very favorable profile of you and Quillette in Politico that I think it was there where it said you had more downloads or following than Harper's Magazine or the New York Review of Books.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Our traffic is quite impressive for our size and how young we are. So we get 3 million page views a month. I think 1 million of those are unique, so new visitors.
Yeah.
So we're very happy with that.
And anyone who hasn't checked out Quillette, go right away, because it's consistently... You know, the articles I find, they're intellectually serious, they are scholarly but readable, accessible, and original. You read things in Quillette, they just don't sound like articles you read anywhere else. And it's not that it's arch-conservative. It's that it's just a group of, seems like eclectic group of free thinkers, not entirely predictable.
Mm-hmm.
And addressing topics outside the rigid confines of, you know, contemporary ideology.
Yeah, that's what we're aiming for. And we do select essays on the basis of their literary merit and originality over and above some ideological litmus test. So we don't select essays because they confirm our biases. We try not to anyway, but if something is original, unusual, strange, then we want to read it and we want to publish it.
Yeah.
And we've attracted some really brilliant thinkers, and we're very lucky to have them in our
network.
Were
you the first to publish Coleman Hughes?
We were.
Oh, what a find. How would you then describe your politics?
I consider myself a centrist, and I think in different contexts my politics change. So in an Australian context, I'm probably on the right, so centre-right. However, in an American context, I'd be centre-left, I think. Not because I subscribe to identity politics or anything like that, but I generally support things like universal health care and progressive taxation and things like that, which we have in Australia. So it's not so much of an issue in Australia, but I can see that if I was in another context, I would be advocating for some of those sort of old school leftist policies a bit more. But I'm not terribly concerned with politics at the moment. My interest is in culture primarily, and I think we've got very regressive strains of authoritarian tribalistic identity politics, and so
on both the far right and far left.
That's right. Yeah, and so my primary concern is just bringing back freedom and cultural libertarianism,
an uninhibited discussion.
Yeah,
and just wherever the conversation goes, and then if you're wrong or you're
exactly,
someone should push back, and not, you know, suddenly a mob on Twitter demands your head on a platter.
And this idea that we now have to police comedians for saying the right thing or making the correct jokes.
If you don't like the comedian, don't listen.
Well, unless he exposes himself to you, then that's a bit of a problem.
Yeah.
But let's talk about the intellectual dark web, which has, you told me this was a kind of ironic term, or in this room it's really the intellectual
blonde
web. Intellectual highlighted web.
Or as some people, I tweeted that we were the intellectual blonde web and sent out a picture of all of us, and someone dared to say, well, it looks to me like the intellectual dark roots web.
Yeah, well, it kind of is that too.
Kind of is. We own it.
But I mean, even if it began as a kind of funny term to describe these so-called dangerous ideas that were emerging against, as you describe, ideology, that's a more kind of like classic liberal enlightenment space, a centrist space, which is hard to find outlets for these days. It's still, I mean, there was an article in the New York Times about the intellectual dark web, but written by Barry Weiss. But when they photographed, Christina was in it, and they photographed you, I mean, they made you, it looked like a Halloween shoot, you know? It was dark, it was scary, there was light coming down.
Camille Paglia, my friend, was so angry with me that I allowed myself to be photographed that way. And she told me she always demands to, you know, be in control of the shoot and so forth.
Well, David Brooks, years ago, said whenever, like, the New York Times comes to photograph conservatives, they always do it in black and white.
Yeah.
And it's very grainy.
I learned that when I did Who Stole Feminism, a Boston Globe reporter came and wanted me to be outside by electrical wires. I had this cute blouse on, and I just wanted to be. I said, can't we go by the flowers over there? And no, by the, you know.
Right, right. But so let's talk about that. Why, Claire, do you think what you publish, your ideas we all generally share, are considered part of the dark web?
I think the question is, why are they considered controversial? Mm-hmm. And they're probably considered controversial because some of these conversations and some of these ideas are not particularly welcome on university campuses these days due to the homogenous groupthink that is present on university campuses. And I don't think that many of the arguments we publish are particularly controversial, but in the context of university life, which is where intellectual discourse is meant to occur, they are. And it's just a sad reflection on the state of universities, really, that these ideas and these conversations we have are considered controversial at all.
This is equally true in Australia, in Canada, as in the United States.
Oh, I know. And I'm surprised that other people haven't grabbed this opportunity because there's so obviously a gap in the market and a market need and demand for this kind of commentary, as even publications like The New Yorker have drifted to the left.
Exactly,
to the far
especially
left.
The website.
Yeah. And so I think that has occurred because the latest crop of graduates who are trained in media or English studies or any kind of cultural studies have emerged from universities where things like intersectionality are taught as fact and these ideas like
male privilege and
how much of this is driven by millennial? I mean, I spoke to one editor who said, like, the older editors were kind of terrified by these younger employees, and it's as if
who turn them in,
and who are probably running the websites because they're older.
Right.
So it does seem that there's a kind of old establishment versus these employees, and even though they're much more junior, they seem to wield terror over these publications.
Yeah, a friend of mine who works in a prestigious publication told me that the adults at her publication are literally terrified of being called a racist or a sexist by their junior colleagues. And they're so terrified of that that they don't push back when their junior colleagues make these unreasonable demands and expect journalists to not report the facts. So there's a younger generation of journalists and writers who feel or who perceive journalism as a kind of advocacy.
Right.
And your role is not necessarily to report the facts, because if you report on the facts, you might normalize the far right. So if you report on, for example, a neo-Nazi and you describe the restaurant he goes to or the movies he watches or the everyday activities in his life, then that's normalizing the far right, and that's bad, and so that shouldn't be done. Whereas the old guard view journalism in a more traditional manner, which is, well, we need to report on reality. If there are uncomfortable things in the world, we have to go and investigate them and report on them. And they don't see that process as normalizing anything. It's investigating it and bringing it to light.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a bit of a schism, I think, with the younger generation of journalists who don't view reporting as the priority, but sort of using journalism as a means of advocacy or activism.
You know, what bothers me so much about this, and it was put very well by Alice Dreger, the writer, scholar, and she said that you can't put justice before truth.
Yeah.
You have to pursue the truth in order to find justice, because you have to have good information. It has to be reality-based.
Yeah.
And this worries me so much, especially what I've studied in the scholarship on gender. There's so much hyperbole, misinformation, spin.
Mm-hmm.
And I just don't see how that helps women.
Well, activism is more effective if you have solid facts.
And this, I just don't know where this will go. A women's movement that's knocking down doors that are already open, that's telling young women they live in they're captive to, you know, the male hegemony and so forth. Mm.
When ultimately, it's very disempowering for women to be constantly told those stories.
Exactly. This is what worries me. Imagine being a young woman and told the world's, you know, it's all rigged against you.
Yeah.
And don't go into science, you know, it's just full of harassers and men who want to hold you back. No, it's not. There are harassers. There are men who will hold you back. But, I mean, I was in philosophy. It's a male-dominated field. And for every Neanderthal, there were so many men who helped me and encouraged me.
Well, that's interesting, because that brings up, Claire, what you published, the story of the firing from Google of James Damore. Mm. Now, he did kind of what you did say that men don't do in sciences, which he did say that women aren't capable of science in the same way as men.
No, he didn't say that. He said that they might. His argument was about preferences, that the pool of people who want to do computer science is the pool has far more men than women, and he entertained various hypotheses.
But he didn't he say something about the abilities of women in science? I mean, it was, you know, he shouldn't have been sacked for it, but.
Right. There is some evidence that men have, you know, better spatial reasoning skills, and this gives them an advantage in the math-based fields. And if you go very far out, you know, on the ability spectrum, you find slightly more men who, you know, who have people with freakishly high IQs.
Yeah.
It's something like 2-to-1 favoring men. So they're the pool, but I doubt he finds that a sufficient explanation, because most of the scientists and computer programs aren't geniuses. They're just very smart people. There are just as many smart women, but they're different interests. That was primarily his argument.
And in his defense, he did frame all of his arguments by saying that he was talking about statistical averages, and that, of course, outliers exist. And he also acknowledged that the women already working in Google were outliers. Everyone working in Google is an outlier, because they're on the right-hand side of the bell curve in terms of scientific ability. So what he was saying didn't actually apply to his colleagues. And I think he wrote that, misremembering, but I think he actually wrote that in the memo. He wasn't actually talking about his colleagues. He was talking about the pool of people and women from which you draw computer science graduates and employees. So if the pool of women is smaller than the pool of men, then of course you're going to have fewer women working for your company. So he wasn't actually addressing his colleagues directly. He was making sort of broader statistical arguments about.
But you published
averages.
In attempted to a sort of fair-minded review of what he had said and the firing. And your website was attacked, right? What happened?
Well, we published just before he was fired, or the news broke that he was fired, and we crashed pretty soon after that, and that would have been because of excessive traffic.
Oh, okay.
However, it didn't. We got it back up, and then we went down again, and I had various people working on it helping me trying to sort it out, and they were convinced that we suffered a denial of service attack. And it was partly my fault, because I didn't have the adequate infrastructure in place to sort of defend against denial of service attacks, and
explain what that is?
It's when you get super huge spikes in traffic in at one time from bots around the world. And sometimes these are deliberate attacks mm-hmm. from hackers. Sometimes they just happen because of various bot activities.
It had to be bots. It wasn't just that everybody wanted to go on your platform and read these articles?
About an employee in Google, and we know the powers of Google. I mean, yes. It's like Voldemort. I'm sure they could do whatever they wanted.
We're never going to know for sure what happened, but people who I trust, engineers, were convinced at the time that there was a denial of service attack. Yeah.
Well, some of the other reports you've done, I liked, maybe this was one of your... This was in 2015, mm-hmm. where you wrote about there were reports in the Australian media that said domestic violence was the leading cause of death among women. And you have a background in forensic psychology, right? Or was this one of the inspirational story, like that sort of saying, no, this is just simply not true?
Not really, because these kinds of zombie or false statistics are shared so often and so frequently that it's just sort of background noise. But I was just, I'm not sure what the year was, probably 2013 or something mm-hmm. like that, and I started noticing this statistic being reported on in Australian media and online that domestic violence was the leading cause of death for women
they
under...
Really? Claim that? More than heart disease? More than cancer?
That's like your Super Bowl domestic abuse statistic when you...
Yeah. And it's so obviously not true if you consider car crashes and... fatal overdoses. But I think it was for women under 45. So young,
but it's still not true.
Yeah. So I just... I mean, the statistics are available at the Census Bureau of Statistics on the ABS website in Australia, and you can look up the leading causes of death, and it's, I think it's car accidents, followed by fatal overdoses, drug overdoses, and suicide.
Yeah. Yeah. For younger women.
Yeah. And homicide, I think, is in the top 10, but it's not in the top 3. And then I found the original report that claim was coming from. And to make the claim that domestic violence was the leading cause of death for women, what they did was they surveyed women, these researchers surveyed women who had ever experienced domestic violence, and they recorded the health problems that these women had in their lifetime.
Oh.
And then they attributed all of these health problems to the domestic violence they had experienced. But their study was a cross-sectional study. It wasn't longitudinal. They didn't survey women who experienced domestic violence and then look at the problems they had afterwards. So the health problems could have existed before the violence and after. They didn't control for the time frame. And they included things like cervical cancer as being caused by domestic violence.
Well, we all know that's true.
So it was just the most...
a catastrophe. I know. I've seen this many times, and I'm appalled.
This report in Australia, which claimed that cervical cancer was somehow caused by domestic violence, this report was produced by a government department in Victoria, and the report was never published in an academic journal and never went through a basic process of peer review. I think it was maybe presented at some kind of UN conference. So very minimal standards of any kind of vetting. And yet, because it was a government report, reporters trusted it. And I think it's a problem of journalists not having any scientific training and not being able to look at a methodology of a study and seeing straight away that it's a rubbish study, because if you have some scientific training, it's pretty easy. I mean, that study I'm referring to is probably, you can't get a more rubbish study than that. Like sometimes studies look a bit more sophisticated and are a bit more impressive, and so you need a higher level of skill to be able to pinpoint the methodological flaws. But this one was so obviously problematic, it wouldn't take much training at all to be able to recognise that. But journalists have very little training at all in this type of thing. And it's just unfortunately, it's just unfortunate that once they repeat these kinds of statistics that get taken as at face value and people have very little skepticism.
Oh, and they get in the media echo chamber and then they take on a life of their own.
Yeah.
This is true, as you said, on the right as well as left. One of, you know, these studies are citing that women are safer with guns.
Right.
And, you know, that's just disproven, but... It's taken as a sort of point of religion.
And
you know?
NRA advocates can conjure a study, get it in. Mm-hmm. But I would say many journalists would be more skeptical if it comes from the right. What worries me is they're so gullible and just credulous when it comes to a victim statistic about women. And we've been coping with this for years. And these phony statistics have been around so long that, as I said, they've taken on the aura of truth. And when you question them, you're thought to be a crank, a dangerous backlash. What did you face backlash?
Yeah, what
from
kind
question?
Of backlash have you had?
I haven't had that much backlash at all, to be honest. I think people were actually quite shocked that this dodgy claim was being repeated by our national broadcaster, for example. And I think even... at one stage, a police department was repeating this statistic, but once they realized that the claim was just false, they stopped immediately. So I think when that happened in Australia, people were quite open-minded and once they realized that, well, no, there are other leading causes of death for young women, I think they stopped making that claim pretty quickly. And so with my earlier work, when I was starting out and writing, I really wanted to emphasize that criticism of feminism or feminist claims is not the same thing as criticizing women, and it's not anti-women. Feminism and women are two separate things, and I really wanted to make that clear. And
I think it's pro-women, trying to get the
good,
best.
But how long have we been arguing this, Christina? I mean, this
forever.
Is the same as it was. Tell us a little bit more about you. I mean, we're looking at this beautiful young woman who's having to continue this fight for truth against false statistics, which has been going on for a long time. But you have two children, married. Tell us a little bit about... And how do you manage? I know that's a question we get in trouble for asking women, but I'm going to ask it.
Never ask men this.
Yeah. Well, honestly, working, doing a startup, running a startup, and having two small children under five is not something I would recommend. It's very difficult. However, I am lucky in that I've had an extraordinary team around me helping me, and by that I mean my co-editors. Mm-hmm. So they were at the party last night, Jamie Palmer, Toby Young, Jonathan Kay, all men.
Wonderful team, wonderful team.
Yeah.
Well, there were a lot of men, too, in the that came.
And a lot of them were swarming you.
Yes.
Christina has a lot of male acolytes.
Yeah. But I view human achievement as being often a collaborative effort. We can't do it all by ourselves. And so I'm married, I have a husband, and I knew early on that it would be impossible to ever be a parent and have young children without a husband. And I am pro-individualism, but I often think we forget about how much we depend on each other and how much we need each other. And to get good work done and achieve important things, we need to have good teams and trusting teams and work together, men and women working together in families, also in the workplace. I think so much of the discourse, particularly the feminist discourse, completely downplays the need for interdependence and how important interdependence is for accomplishing goals, whether they're family goals, work goals, community goals.
But even in, you know, given your youth, that so many, we've talked about this a lot on the podcast, millennials, iGen, they're delaying marriage.
Yeah, yeah.
I think they're very confused about marriage.
Yeah.
And it's not just out of ideology that women are, you know, don't. I think there's really no conception anymore of roles.
Yeah.
And expectations they don't know what to expect or how to. So how have you found navigating marriage?
Yeah, well, I as a younger person in my 20s, I thought about these issues very deeply, and I thought about how I wanted to... Because I always wanted a career, mm-hmm. and I wanted children, and I wanted to be married, and I had to figure out the timing of these things. And, you know, it's not easy for women in today's world to figure out exactly what is the right path for them. Mm-hmm. And one thing I wish we would talk about more is trade-offs. You know, if you want to have a family young, which is better for you health-wise and probably better for your children health-wise.
I think somebody wrote this in a book called What Our Mothers Didn't Tell Us.
Danielle's book, first book.
Exactly.
Yeah. That's it. You know, having children before you get to your 40s is optimal. Mm. Often women aren't told that, but your career is going to take a hit. But I'm of the view that considering that we're working for so long anyway, you know, people don't retire now until their 70s, who really cares if your career in your 20s or your early 30s takes a hit? You can make up time, I think. So I wish that we would have more creative conversations for women, like about how to manage and get achieve what you want to achieve, but in your own on your own terms,
right,
with your own time frame.
And taking into account female biology.
Exactly.
And
exactly.
You know what I see sometimes in the feminist movement is they've been very good at helping women find ways, you know, not to have a baby, or to get birth control, to get abortions, and that's all well and good.
Yeah.
But what about women that want to have babies?
And that's most women.
Which is most women.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that it's going to be so central to your...
Well, in Claire's case, even between when I was writing about this in 2000 and now, of course, the technology has changed that you talk about doing a startup magazine, I assume, in your house with two small children and any startup and...
Yeah.
Anything like this is, well, pretty much anything is hard with small children. And whether you're a man or woman, it's a different time of life, but you have managed to do it.
Yeah, it is hard. But I have to say, when I talk to my friends who have babies and who have professional jobs, their lives sound harder. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm still working very hard, but it's on my terms. And it's
from home.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's, you know...
It's so much better.
I decide the hours, and I don't have a boss frowning at me if I leave early to go and pick up my kids or if I take a day off because one of my children is sick. And not having someone else's expectations on me is very liberating. And so I can get my work done. I can work hard, but it's still on my terms. And I hear stories from friends who... have colleagues who sort of give them bad vibes if they leave the office at 6 o'clock to go and pick up their baby who is in daycare. And it just sounds utterly miserable. But this is the experience of many, many women. And
that has not changed.
Yeah,
it's not changed.
It's not, I don't think it's optimal. Really.
And how does your husband, does he work in an office or does...
Yeah, well, we work in an office together. He has his own business as well. And I work in an office with him. And so we both work hard, but we both have our own hours. So we both have flexibility.
Yeah.
So if I have an engagement, a speaking engagement or an interview or something like that, he will look after the children. And so we've both structured our lives in a way that is family friendly, but also gives us the space to have achievements as well and have our own.
So that that's
path.
Also a very modern way and you found your husband completely open to this, obviously.
Absolutely.
A lot of young men are.
Yeah.
The young men are so proud and impressed by successful women. I think it's a huge myth that men feel threatened. I don't think so.
It's charismatic, and of course, it's attractive. And unless you have some neurotic guy you shouldn't be involved with anyway.
Yeah, yeah.
But you know what? Another thing I want to say that's so wonderful about Quillette is that it's cool. And like that event last night, that party, and I think it's because you're cool and a role model for young women, not a stodgy conservative or a crazy angry leftist or anything, just, you know, a relatable, lovely person.
Mm. We think we're normal people.
And is some of your funding Canadian? Like, where? What brought the Toronto angle? Brought us all here in January.
Well, my Canadian editor, Jonathan Kays,
who's terrific,
based in Toronto, and I was brought out here to give a speech to some law students this weekend, and I thought, well, let's have a Quillette Christmas party in January, and I'll bring out my London editors. So I have two editors in London. I was thinking of having a party in Sydney, but then it's less expensive for me to have.
Well, maybe have it when I'm there. I'm coming there to debate.
Yeah.
Roxane Gay,
if anybody has advice.
Yeah, I'll definitely be there. But we hope to have more parties in New York, San Francisco, London, and maybe one day Sydney as well.
Well, we like any movement with parties.
We're all about the parties. And there were great drinks last night. And speeches.
And it was a lot of fun. Well, thank you. Thank you for coming and sitting with us in the studio and for having us to your event last night. And we love your publication. And it's Quillette.com.
Yes, support it and read it. And you'll be edified.
Thanks so much.
Thanks, Claire.
Cheers.
Okay, I can't have helped but notice, Christina, that Zoe was giggling.
During the break
and, while the interview was airing, because she has looked more into...
It's Mel Magazine.
Well, it intrigued me because their about page, when I was trying to figure out what Mel meant, said that we write about dicks a lot. And I said,
yeah,
okay.
You said that, and we're like... Okay,
general statement.
Fine. All right.
They have an entire section of their website that's just called Dicks. And it's all articles that are related to penises. So
please tell me there aren't dick pics.
There is one. Not an actual dick pic. It's an article about men. I just noticed it and pointed it out. Men who like to send flaccid dick pics.
What?
They're really interesting.
Why would
you? It's called Meet the Softies.
Oh, but you know what? Okay, I just want to say I've never received such a thing. I grew up in a time where we just didn't have
no
that.
Such thing happened.
I don't think Canadians do that.
And the Canadians don't do that.
No, we didn't have this bizarre capacity.
But
you know what I've always wondered? Okay, just put it out there. So when Jeff Bezos sent his mistress his dick pic, and it was described as big by a friend, thank God for him, right? Not like Trump.
Yeah.
It was mushroom. Okay, let's not go there. But is it soft? Or is it like, what's it doing? Like, what do men do? Is it sent in a full...
You mean... I've never received a flaccid dick pic.
Oh, so you have received the
article? Oh, yes.
Oh, my God. Mm-hmm. And Zoe reveals all.
And oftentimes you don't ask for it. Like, it's like your daughter. It's like Miranda said.
Oftentimes, but you occasionally have.
Sometimes...
This is the research assistant abuse. I'm sorry.
Well, Mel Magazine.
Totally inappropriate, and now you're going to be arrested. But go on.
I think.
So men are doing, what do they say, like, thinking of you?
Or... Oftentimes there's no caption or context. And it's on Snapchat, so you can't save it forever. Like what Miranda did and send it to their mom and
or
say,
unlike
look what
Bezos'
you
mistress. Like, yeah. Clearly. Okay, so we have a very short time.
No, I want to go back to... Okay, no, we won't. Let's leave it.
Just leave it.
No, I'm talking about the diversity. About
I know.
The discrimination.
I know. You have to stop this.
Okay.
You have to stop this. Okay. So we had very brief listener feedback that Zoe has compiled.
Yes, ma'am.
So go for it.
So I would say one of the most controversial topics that I did not expect was controversial on the Femsplainers was when we discussed Janu-Harry.
That's pretty controversial, Zoe.
Maybe it's just because I went to liberal arts colleges and lots of women don't shave their legs. Well, we received a lot of funny responses. Sally told us, we've been doing it in Canada for years and years. It's called winter.
That's true.
So, you know, the Canadians, I was a little offended by this one. Phil says that everyone that doesn't shave their legs, that's a woman, that they're all future cat ladies. Now, as a cat woman who
so
shaves
only
her
have
legs,
one cat. You only true. Have one cat. The minute you get two cats, you're a cat lady. You're okay. Not a cat lady yet.
What if he's the size of two cats?
Well, no, two cats and beyond, you're a cat lady, and single ladies, watch out for that. Okay, go on. That's true.
So this one is more of a question that she posed to us. So Alex said, or sorry, he posed to us. He said,
Alex.
Oh, no, it was a man. Oh. I remember.
Okay.
He said, I won't lie and pretend shaved legs / armpits aren't more attractive, but do you both really not see anything silly about a cultural taboo against female body hair? Isn't this a relatively recent phenomenon? What is the value of associating beauty with hairlessness?
Good question, Alex.
It changes from era to era. And, you know, for example, now it is the norm, and we've talked about this, to wax down below.
Wax everywhere, even for men. Like, it's gone.
Even for men.
Waxing extremes, yeah.
And if you go back to the 1970s and look at photos, people were very hairy.
Mm-hmm.
Men were hairy. Their backs, men were hairy and didn't shave and so forth. And women as well. And it was sexy.
I know, but there's also standards of beauty. And as you say, they change from era to era. But...
but I would not welcome the hairy leg.
No, it's not even the hairy leg so much as the hairy armpits.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, come on.
So, I will say, I was after I posted this and got such a reaction on Twitter, I started looking around a little bit, and the Glamour magazine mentioned, well, they had this woman, this beautiful woman, but very hairy legs. They mentioned, oh well, Rihanna has gone, you know, shaving her legs. And she's posted these pictures on Instagram. And I thought, wow, if Rihanna's doing it, this is really happening. Well, I look at the picture, and she's got, like, faintest little peach fuzz. I mean, just like, yeah. Just cute. It doesn't count.
And any woman with a mustache, come on.
Mustache or unibrow?
And yeah, what I noticed. Unibrows. What about unibrows? No one wants to look like Frida Kahlo, not even a man.
Not even a man.
Not even a man. Okay. All right, go on.
Another topic that raised some controversy was our thin privilege topic.
That's serious.
And my favorite comment we received from Debbie, she was listening with a group of people, and she said, I was eating pizza while I was listening, and I received so many side glances.
Oh,
what the hell?
I thought we sounded mean talking about
it. No, we didn't. Okay, here's what our point was, if I recall to that conversation, was just like, there are a lot of things people are going to have judgment on, and like we do, like, you know, Alex disagrees with our take on hair, but it's not a right. Like, you don't have to approve.
What we object to is the idea that being thin is a privilege, because I still insist that it is
hard,
impossible, and actually, it kills you. It kills
and,
you.
And I think,
unless it comes naturally to like 2% of people.
Well, and I think the obesity issue, which is a serious health issue in this country and growing with diabetes and everything associated with poor health and obesity, that if there is some sense you can control it, that's a good thing.
But don't you like, just to play devil's advocate, don't you like the fact that in the magazines, the models are just sometimes a little... you know,
Zoftic. Yeah, look,
age-enhanced.
And look, it's like Sophia Loren and the curvaceous models of the 50s, you know? Beauty standards change. But what I really dislike is being told that I have to approve of all of your life choices. It's a right, you know, and that you being 400 pounds, yeah, fine, that's your preference, live your life. No one's going to, you know, say that that's not your choice. But to say that it's to be preferred or equal to being healthy, or that you shouldn't try, I mean, presuming there's not some underlying
medical condition. People who are 400 pounds haven't made a choice. I mean, I think
look, if there's some underlying condition, but if you've got an eating disorder in terms of, you know,
or a drinking problem,
she says, pouring more drink.
Oh, God.
No, but it is. Eating junk food is a similar disorder to drinking, to opioids, to video game playing, to gambling, and to just pretend it's about a preference and it's about aesthetics and no one should have a judgment on that. I think that's misguided.
What I find misguided is, as I said, this idea that thin people have to apologize for their unearned advantages because it was earned.
True. True. All right. Anything else, Zoe?
Yes, I have one more to close on.
Okay.
And this is all about your wonderful adventure to Toronto. Mm. The two of you put out this beautiful picture of the intellectual blonde dark web.
Well, intellectual dark web now is the intellectual blonde web.
Okay. That's better.
Yeah.
And someone said that you should do an intellectual blonde round table on the podcast.
Well, this is what we do every week.
No, that is true. No, we should bring them all in.
That's what I'm saying. But I think they wanted to say, you know, perhaps in the future we bring on,
we have had Dr. So. I think she was season one.
She was one of the first episodes I was here for.
Yeah, so I think Deborah So was season two. And we're having, of course, Claire. We had Claire on this episode. So we're bringing you all these awesome blonde and brunette, and we're diverse in hair color.
Yes, and
everything really
waxed.
We're waxed.
I'm assuming.
All right. So, Christina, how do our listeners find us on social media?
Well, they can follow us on Twitter, Facebook at Femsplainers. Instagram at Femsplainers Podcast. You can also write to us. Just contact at femsplainers.com and find all episodes and subscription options at femsplainers.com.
Thank you. Look forward to talking to you again. Bye-bye.
Bye.